And we're ready to begin. My name is Brian Eshenaur. Today we have Dan Gilrein, and Betsy Lamb is assisting in, she's traveled to Buffalo, New York, and doing that remotely there. Anyway, today's session is on insect and plant disease monitoring. We're going to get started first with a reminder about some basics of monitoring in the greenhouse and high panels, and a few slides of some diseases. And Dan's going to talk to us about insect and mite monitoring. And here's a shot of both of us. And let's get started. So it's a greenhouse, has a sticky car there you can see for insect monitoring. But first, we're going to start with some disease monitoring. Some of these will cut across for both insects and diseases. So monitoring or scouting can be both formal or informal. And in a formal way, it could be a hired scout. Several greenhouse growers that we work with have a hired scout that comes out on a once a week basis or at a set interval to come out, take a close look at the crops, and then give a report to the head grower. It can be done informally by somebody who's assigned to do that. And it is important, if it is informal, that the assignment of scouting falls to somebody. Otherwise, it might just fall by the wayside, and it is an important thing to do. So it could be that everybody who waters needs to keep an eye out for problems. And I know one grower who really makes a point of talking to people that are out in the greenhouses and getting their information. So if there's anything that looks a little bit off to them, they're telling the grower so he can follow up on that. So it is important that it is an acknowledged, responsibility. And visual inspection really begins with the new plants as they come in. Those plants and plugs, when they arrive to the greenhouse, it should be looked at for both insects and diseases, and isolated if necessary. And then once the plants are growing, really taking an unhurried walkthrough. So slowly looking at the plants. And as I said, this a good time to do this if you're on a manual watering system is when you're watering the plants. Otherwise, you know, go out there and take your time as you're going through the greenhouse, looking for anything off, whether that's wilting, yellowing, other kinds of symptoms for diseases, and then of course any signs of insects or mites that you might see as well. When you're doing this, don't be afraid to turn the leaves over, look on the underside, and also slip the plants out of the pots, especially important for diseases to do this, to take a look, see what the healthy roots should look like there. And if you do that routinely, you'll be able to see when something's a little bit off, maybe there's some pythium or black root rot in there. And then it's really important to report and document the problems, whether this is something that you would have people that are out in the greenhouse give to you either verbally or a written report. And also the notes that you take are important, the details, the more the better. And now that cell phone cameras are so prevalent, you know, just documenting that and then being able to come back and compare the symptoms from 1 week to the next to see if that problem is getting worse. All right, now we're gonna take a look at some specific diseases, and I'm gonna acknowledge and thank Marjorie Daughtry for some of these images that I'm going to use here. She's got a great collection, and I believe this is one of hers. So we're taking a look here at a poinsettia that has some off color to it and some twisting and yelling. Many problems could be causing these symptoms, but this is one that is botrytis. Botrytis really likes those deteriorating leaves and got started on those, and then in that humid environment of the canopy, it took out some of the stems there, and we had the distortion above. And so this is botrytis gray mold. So the most common problem in greenhouses and it really requires that high humidity. So sometimes the key characteristic, though, you won't notice in your scouting until you get down into the canopy and close to the soil line like this symptom is here. Another case of botrytis. In this case, and I don't have a shot of it, but these heliotrope plants were snapping off at the soil line. And take a close look down here. You can see that it is actually that botrytis gray mold that got started there on some weakened leaves. And the other part that you can't see here, but it is good when you're scouting to look for, is the planting depth. Turns out these were actually in about 3/4 to an inch, a little bit too deep. And that created a very humid environment around that central stem. And botrytis was able to take advantage of that and cause some rotting there. Another case of botrytis, and it's getting started on that fallen flower there. And then it's moved onto the leaf surface and caused those symptoms there. And here's another New Guinean patient that has symptoms that look an awful lot like botrytis, but this is in patients' necrotic spot virus. This is a disease that can have a lot of different symptoms. And I just wanted to put it in here because it can look, when you're scouting at first, like something like botrytis, but it is vectored by thrips, and it's an important one to know. Here it is. This one fooled me when I first saw this. This is on Nemesia, and I was out at a greenhouse and assumed that it was botrytis. Brought it back and incubated. Botrytis did not grow out. And then I tested, and it tested positive for this disease in patients with necrotic spot virus. Again, that's thrips vectored, and we want to handle that differently. It's a really important reason to scout, because this disease can spread to just about every crop. And we have some shots of that later here in my presentation. Talked about this previously with the diseases that they can become a problem when there's a humid environment. And in this case, we have a very vigorous variety of coleus growing below, and this is before sales started in the spring, and some hanging baskets above that may be dripping some water down. Here's a good reason that when you're scouting, you want to go and part the canopy and take a look inside, because you might not notice it here just from afar or walking by, but when we start to look inside that coleus canopy, there is some disease that's already started. It started on, again, some of that weakened foliage and has spread over to the stems of the coleus there. And, you know, if air circulation isn't allowed to get in there, this could take out more stems and become more of a problem. So get down into the canopy when you are scouting. And just to contrast botrytis, which is very common, with downy mildews that can be another serious problem in greenhouses, botrytis is going to be a gray color, and that's often on the stems and lower down, where downy mildew is often on the underside of the leaves, and it has a little bit lighter color to it. It's not as thick of a fungal layer. And we can see downy mildews on coleus. This shot was taken in spring of 2013 at a greenhouse where it got cool for a few days, and downy mildew on coleus showed up there. You might not know it just looking at the leaves from the surface, but if we were to flip those leaves over and take a look, then you can start to see the water mold structures that are there. Not completely visible on this slide, but when you're there, you can see that they have a kind of a third dimension. They're sticking out, and that's where the fungal spores or the water mold spores are formed, and it can spread around if the conditions are right. Here's a better shot of that. So in this case, it's unlike botrytis, where it's killing the plant surface. In this case, it's keeping the host surface alive and producing those spores, with the live tissue. So you have to look a little closer for the downy mildew, especially in the beginning. Another shot of a downy mildew infested plant where the plant tissue is alive, yet the water mold is actively growing there and producing spores. Sometimes you do get these necrotic spots on the upper leaf surface. It helps you know that it's there. And sometimes there's defoliation with downy mildew, as in this case. And it can also be a problem on basil. And again, the upper leaf surface is just going to show a little bit of light discoloration where we really can see those water mold structures on the under surface holding up the spores and distributing those. There it is again. In this case, it's on impatiens. And impatiens in the landscape, you might not really notice this before the foliation happens because it can happen pretty darn quick. Let's move on to another one where scouting is really important, especially when the conditions are right, and that's chrysanthemum white rust. This is still a regulated pest, so it's important to take a look for this, and when the conditions are right, be prepared to treat or white rust. And it's just another shot of it. This is what it can do. You notice on the upper leaf surface on the left, the symptoms are a little bit more subtle compared to the underside of the leaves where you have these white pustules that are producing spores. Again, the subtle leaf surface on the subtle symptoms on the upper leaf surface there in this shot. And the lower leaf surface with those pustules producing spores. We're going to move on to a few bacterial diseases. This is one that I'm seeing more and more, and that is with the increased popularities of some of these angel wing type begonias. This xanthomonas disease is more prevalent, and the symptoms are not typical of fungal diseases, and they may look like the lack of watering, like some other physical problem. I think this shot really, you know, you can imagine that these plants got dried out or some other problem was there, but this is due to xanthomonas blight, that bacterial blight. So this can spread too through watering, through splashing. So if you see a plant like this, you would want to isolate it. And these wax begonias are resistant to that. Just want to put a reminder in because these are being used as a substitute for infusion, and we don't see the bacterial blight in these begonias. Now let's take a look at the viruses, and we got a preview of these with the impatiens necrotic spot virus, and we're going to take a look at some more of those symptoms because there's really no typical symptoms for INSV. We have it on the garden impatiens on the upper slide and on New Guinea impatiens below. Often there is some necrotic look, and there's often some rings associated with INSV. Here it is on coleus, just with these dark splotches, but it's both on the leaves and on the stems. Tyrinia with necrosis there, dark splotches, but no real ring spots with Tyrinia. Here it is again in garden impatiens. Here are some ring spots also caused by the same virus on coleus. So it can have many different types of symptoms. We saw it before in Nemesia. Here's a little bit different necrotic spot caused by INSV on Nemesia. So when you're scouting, if you see something that looks brown, I think it's important not to just assume that it, you know, that plant got a little bit dry. This is something that we have tests for, and you could submit it to a diagnostic lab and get a positive identification for this disease. If it is INSV, it'll show up. Here's just a couple other shots of coleus. Then we'll take a look at this canna virus. This has become more and more of a problem as cannas have increased in popularity. There are more than one virus problem that have affected cannas, and they all have similar symptoms with the modeling mosaic type of look, especially you can see that in the upper right. If you pass light, allow light to pass through the leaf, you can really see that type of symptom. Sometimes there is necrosis, and with the multicolored leaves, with varieties that have those, you can see just uneven patterns to that variegation. And as I mentioned, there's more than one virus that causes this problem, Canna yellow mottle, as well as Canna yellow streak virus. And the plants can get both of them at the same time. All right, I'm moving from viruses to powder mildews. These could be missed early on because they're so even. It could even look like a varietal characteristic. But here's some gerberas that are affected. You can see the leaf on the right there is healthy. And of course, the leaf on the left has the fungus growing right on that leaf surface and producing lots of spores that can spread around. In some plants, and including some landscape plants, you can see powdery mildew, rather than being spread over the entire leaf surface, just causing small spots. It's not that common on pansy, but here it is causing these small spots on the pansy leaves. A really important powdery mildew disease to catch early is powdery mildew of poinsettias. This can be a serious problem. It's not that common, but really take a close look at your poinsettia crop through the season, especially closer to the sale time, because this disease can be a serious problem. Again, some of Marjorie's slides here with powdery mildew on poinsettia. And it does kind of look like possibly snow on there, but defoliation does happen with these, so it's something we want to avoid. And finishing up here with black root rot, the leviopsis. This is one when you're scouting. Now, this could easily look like a nutritional problem, and that's because the foliage of this petunia doesn't have the nutrients it needs. It's not getting to the leaves, and that's because the roots are compromised due to this fungal infection. On the right, you can see a compound microscopic view of the fungus, and that's what we look at with the fungus disease. But you can have a pretty good idea when the roots are washed off and you see the really dark areas there contrasting with the lighter, healthy roots. That's a good indication that black root rot or leviopsis is a problem. Here it is on verbena. This plant just never grew well. It's kind of sitting there. See something like that, wash off those roots, take a look for that dark color. It might be black root rot. And there it is in the roots, that microscopic view. Now I'm going to finish up, and we are going to go to Dan. He's going to take over and talk about insect scouting.
Hey, can you hear me okay? Am I coming through all right?
Sounds great.
Okay, wonderful. Well, delighted to be with you all today. Thanks for joining us. This is a topic that really we haven't talked about for quite a while, so I'm really delighted to get to speak about it. And we've done a lot of work with growers trying to develop and understand what monitoring means for greenhouse growers. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that today. Some years ago, our pathologist declared for all that she thought Western flower thrips were spontaneously generated, which I thought was rather funny because I had said the same thing about some of the pathogens that Brian had just been talking about. Well, actually, neither of those are true, but it does seem that way a lot of the time. So what we're going to be talking about is how you can actually detect these early, and then what, where to go looking and how to look, how to refine your looking techniques. Some of these you probably already are doing, but there may be some new things here as well that we can discuss. So we'll proceed here. First of all, we live and work in environments within our greenhouses with other insects and plants are all around us inside of course, and especially outside the greenhouse. And this is the kind of situation that we want to try to avoid, where we have host plants. These had loads and loads of whiteflies on them that were right underneath the vents of the greenhouse itself. The obvious solution to something like this is to make a gravel area that can be made clear and free of weeds. You could have it underlain with landscape fabric. So have at least some distance away from the vent when you're not having host plants or alternate hosts for some of the pests that come in and bother you later on. These are some data from Colin Killing, Ag Canada, work with Graham Murphy, on trying to understand where these Western flower inserts are coming from. And so you can see here, I can see my pointer here, there's a line at the bottom here. These are showing the numbers of thrips that were found on sticky cards on the side of the greenhouse far away from where the vents were. So there's still some. This is going from August until October, and they're getting below 20 per card per week, just a few. But as you get close to the vents, just above that, that pink dotted line shows that cards right inside the vent, you're getting much, much higher numbers. So obviously that's suggesting that there's thrips that are coming in the vent. Right in the vent, you're getting even higher numbers. That dark blue line that you'll see there shows that there's a lot of thrips that are coming in right around the vent. So it's pretty obvious that outdoors was a big source of Western flower thrips coming in this particular rose range. Now, this was an argument for the use of screening, but that is probably impractical or difficult in many cases. But if at least the lesson for us is that these outside sources can be important, and the more difficult you make it for thrips to come in by keeping this weed-free barrier, the better it can be. Well, we don't just have weeds outside the greenhouse, but sometimes they're inside as well, and this is not what we want to see, obviously, because they can serve as hosts for pests themselves. You'll see a little bittercress plant off to the right there. Let's take a closer look at what's going on that little plant. Now, so you could see some streaking and scarring on the leaves here. This is from Western flower thrips, and this plant can be a very nice host for this insect, as well as the tussle virus that Brian was mentioning earlier. Well, that's not all that was on that plant. And if you look right in the center, right here, you'll see there's a nice little aphid hanging out. There's also three parasitized aphids that are on there as well. So someone might say, well, this could be the argument for banker plant weeds to remain in the greenhouse. But I would say that's very nice to have the parasitized aphids, but unfortunately, you're also maintaining the aphid population from crop to crop on these plants. And I would much rather see that we got rid of the weeds along with the aphids as well. Now, down below here, you can see some of the spotting here on that little leaf, which I noticed later. That's actually from the Western flower thrips feeding. So you can tell another way that they've been there. So this is more like we'd like to see. While it demands some maintenance, you have to clean up this landscape fabric. At least it keeps the media from getting down to the gravel and keeps the weeds from sprouting and growing up and maintaining the population down there. So let's talk a little bit about whiteflies. And some of you will remember not too many years ago, a couple of decades ago, when sweet potato whitefly came on the scene and what a huge problem it was for us. We spent a lot of time trying to understand this pest, how to monitor and look for it, then what to do about it, of course. And you can see there's a really huge population here in all different stages, a few adults in the center, some pupal stages that are yellow, some that have hatched where the empty pupil cases are visible, and there's some really, really tiny immature stages, nymphs that are there as well. So you've got kind of the whole family. Well, we know that whiteflies can come from weeds. Here's a case where greenhouse whiteflies were hanging out on a dandelion leaf, and we can get sweet potato whiteflies doing sort of the same thing as well. So you want to try to prevent them from coming from crop to crop or remaining from crop to crop on the weeds themselves. But we also knew that besides maintaining them in our own greenhouses, we can sometimes bring them in on plants. And this is something that's very difficult not to do. Every propagator has a challenge to create propagated material that is perfectly clean. And I don't think anybody is 100% perfect in this regard. So we saw some variations from year to year and from grower to grower. And if you are a propagator that sells propagated materials, I know you've been thinking about this as well. You'd like to send out the cleanest kind of stock as you can. So it just has a good idea to check what you're getting in and see if there's anything on it. Look at the oldest leaves, especially for any evidence or signs that there are thrips there. And Marjorie's commenting privately that I look young in this picture because I was much younger when that picture was taken. Anyway, here's if the crop goes on, then you'll want to have some kind of a regular monitoring or a scouting program on your own, even if it's formal or informal. And Brian mentioned that there are scouts that can be hard to do that in some cases. There is actually a sampling plan, and that's another way that you can conduct formal sampling. And this is specifically tailored for whiteflies in poinsettia, and you'll find the website that's listed there down below. You'll see the scout on the left in that photo has the sunlight behind her, and the light is bouncing off the leaf. So she's got the plant lifted up, looking at the oldest leaf there where the population is most likely to be, and has the sunlight bouncing off the leaf to provide the best visibility possible. This makes it a lot easier. If you have trouble seeing little things, you can get an aqua-visor, which leaves your hands free. We find that works really well with 7X or 10X. Optivizer is a great little tool. You just flip it down when you need, and that's really great for looking for little things like this. If you do find a hot spot, you can put a piece of flagging tape or a flag in it, come back to it, or if you do treat, go back and make sure the things have died. So those are little things you can do to try to enhance the not only your scouting, but also the feedback into the control program. While you're looking for the pest in a crop, in the case of whiteflies here, you'll also want to look for evidence that the natural enemies that you've spent so much money on are out there and doing the job. In this case, Eretmosceris, a little parasitoid wasp, is on the upper left. You probably won't see the little wasps, or very rarely, when you're out there looking, but you might see evidence that they've been there. And on the right here is a parasitized pupal case, and it turns kind of brown instead of this normal pale or yellow color that they were more expected to be. In this picture on the left, you'll see some empty pupal cases. Here's a few. Here's one that's been parasitized and emerged. You can see the little round hole and the discolored appearance here. There's a few others that look like they've been parasitized down here and the upper left, and maybe even this one as well. But this little parasitoid is also happily a vigorous predator, and it will feed on the smaller immature stages and kill them in the process. So here's one that has been fed upon, and it looks sort of dry and crispy, and that's dead. This one is dead, and this one is dead, and probably that one as well. So if you can tell sometimes, it's a little difficult, but you can sometimes see that they're in action by looking for those dead immature stages, as well as evidence of parasitized pupae, which aren't not necessarily as abundant. And if you're dealing with Encarsia, a different species, the appearance will be different. If you're dealing with greenhouse whitefly, and we have seen a little bit more of that coming back, you'll get these black parasitized pupae instead of this normal pale color. If you're dealing with sweet potato whitefly, you can kind of see in the background there's this brownish tan sort of coloring that they get when they're parasitized in Encarsia. Encarsia is not the best parasitoid for sweet potato whitefly. Eretmosceris is a much better one, but if you happen to be using Encarsia, you could you would see that. While you're looking for these natural enemies, look for anything new and interesting you might see, of course, in the pest department, but also in the natural enemy area. This is the hunter fly, and we've dealt with several growers who were completely unaware that they had these in their greenhouse and thought that all those little flies were shore flies, and they do look a little bit alike, but hunter fly is grayer, shore fly is black, and hunter flies are also a little bit bigger. And they behave a little differently. You can see this one's got a little fungus gnat in its clutches there. So keep your eyes peeled. You might see something like this in your greenhouse. And instead of feeling like you've got a shore fly problem control, you've actually got something that's controlling the shore flies all doing it for you. Let's talk a little about Western flower thrips. On the left, you'll see this is a trial we ran looking at different controls for Western flower thrips. And you can see the huge amount of damage in that one treatment with those pink tags. And it's relatively clean on the right. So you really want to try to prevent populations of Western flower thrips before you get to this blooming or even the bud stage when it can be really difficult to control them. One thing that we know about Western flower thrips is they really like pollen, and that's one reason why they really like flowers. So it's a good place to go looking for them if you have flowers around. You can just look with your eyes for these tiny thrips. They're hard to see. Or to make it a little easier, you can tap them over a light-colored paper on a board, or you can blow into them. And the thrips, for some reason, come running out in response to that. That makes it a lot easier for them to detect. But you don't always have flowers around. And sometimes, in this case, we have flowers here for African violets, you can just see that there's evidence that they're infested because the pollen has been falling from the damaged pollinia, the pollen sacs on those blooms. This alone can make the plants unmarketable, especially if you're dealing with these darker colored blooms like purple or these violet colored flowers. They'll have a sort of dusty appearance and growers won't be able to sell them. So you want to prevent even this kind of damage as well. So you may not actually be able to see the thrips or the pollen falling from the flowers, but you might see the damage to the petals. And you can see a couple of circled areas on the similar area there that are really clear evidence that you've got some thrips activity going on. And Brian mentioned TOSPA virus problems. You'll see symptoms of that on the non-stop begonias in the upper left. And of course, you can have TOSPA virus without having thrips at all. You can have thrips without TOSPA virus, but one of the things you really do not want to have is both together because you have the ingredients for a very serious problem under that under the situation. You can look for other evidence. You may not see the scar, that kind of scarring, but here you can actually see some little droppings, little dark specks inside that bloom that were left from where the thrips are feeding, and there's one little thrips on the side that you can see. But Western flower thrips doesn't like just flowers. It also likes foliage, and some plants definitely more than others, and even things like mums on some varieties more than others. You'll see damage on leaves. And here you can see what the symptoms look like on a tomato leaf. You could see little these little pepper spots left by their droppings, as well as the scarring from where they were actually eating on the cells of the leaf there. Now, poinsettia is not a very good host for Western flower thrips, but if they feed on those younger, tender leaves, you'll get this sort of result later on. They don't seem to breed in poinsettia. They don't stick around very long, but especially if you have poinsettias getting started at the end of the bedding plant season or at the end of summer where there's some thrips running around, you may see evidence of this that suggests that you're indicates that you've had thrips around within the last few weeks or so. This is a picture from a propagation house. The skip laurels are being propagated, and you can see some Western flower thrips damage, how strange it makes that plant look, because those were leaves were damaged when they were quite small. Now, Western flower thrips is not the only thrip we deal with, but we can see other ones, and they don't behave the same way. This is greenhouse thrips damage on a poinsettia leaf, and you can see all the scarring along the edge here, and there's a lot of little droppings that they've left behind as well. And if you look on the top of the leaf, you'll see some thrips here, but also on the bottom of the leaf over here, there's some white immature stages, and you'll find a few black thrips there as well to show you that you can actually see the thrips there too. And this one doesn't have a fondness for flowers like Western flower thrips does. This is a different kind of thrips, Ficus benjamina, sometimes called weeping fig thrips, and you can see the sort of odd galling that it causes on leaves there. And when you open up the leaves, you can see the black thrips inside. Chili thrips is probably even more important that we concern ourselves with. This is a fairly new one, and we've seen a few cases in greenhouses as well as outdoors. On the right, you'll see a comparison of the two kinds of thrips. This is Western flower thrips, the larger one, and this one is the chili thrips, the smaller one. It's really small, really tiny, almost half the size of Western flower thrips, so they become even harder to see. But what you more often notice is the symptoms that they cause from the feeding. And they don't go to flowers very readily. Mostly they go to foliage, and you can see on the upper left begonia damage, lower left on hetera, and the lower right is hydrangea injury. And there's a little bit of powdery mildew probably in the hydrangea causing some of the purpling symptoms. But the curling and the stunting and the distortion is all very distinctive for chili thrips damage on foliage. It looks an awful lot like broad mite damage. So if you see these symptoms, those are the two things that you might think about. You probably have either chili thrips or broad mite present. And it's a matter of trying to figure out which it is. You could try to tap leaves, foliage over a paper to look for the thrips. As they say, they're really tiny. You won't see many of them on those older mature leaves. They're going to be in the very center tender growth. And so that's what you have to target your looking. So that's a little bit on thrips. And we're going to get into some other monitoring techniques for white flies and thrips in a moment. I want to mention a little bit about two-spotted spider mite. This is the two-spotted mites under the leaf of a rose, and you can see lots of little white eggs there as well. There's a lot of adult female mites as well as eggs there, and so that population is getting set to explode very, very soon. Now, before you see that, you'll probably start to see symptoms of infestation, looking like these little pale flecks on leaves, at least on roses. This is what it typically looks like. Now, this infestation is well along, and it's been there for quite a while. You'll really want to try to see these if you're very sensitive to it very early on in the stage of infestation. Look at the lowest leaves first. The leaves that have been around the longest are the ones that are most often going to show symptoms, signs of infestation. Now, two-spotted mite injury does not look the same on all kinds of plants. This is the early appearance on zonal draining. And zonal drains are kind of a surprise that we never suspected could be getting infested by two spotted spider mites. But this is what the early signs of damage look like on a zonal drain two spotted mite infestation. When you turn the leaves over, you'll notice a lot of edema. And even on this leaf, you can see some of the mites. There's a few little ones here and maybe here and here. You can actually see a few of them there. But edema is sometimes an indication of a nutrient problem in geraniums, especially in ivy geraniums, maybe not so much in zonals, but you might wonder if that's what's going on. But if you can actually see the mites, then you're pretty sure you've got two spotted spider mites. This is two spotted mite damage on the zonal graining again, and you can see it's really, really well advanced. It almost looks like a botrytis problem or some of the other disease symptoms that Brian was mentioning. Xanthomonas comes to mind. We've had samples that look like this that people thought was Xanthomonas, a bacterial leaf spot disease, that really ended up being two-spotted spider mite. On darker colored foliage, those symptoms, those lighter flecks, may not be so apparent. And although it's really heavy infestation, it's very obvious on this Ipomia, you could see that just based on color alone, you might not necessarily think that there was a mite infestation, especially if the mites in the webbing were not there. So turning over the leaves, fortunately, you can often see the paler mites against the darker background. And you can see on the right that that's pretty obvious. Here's Lewis mite, another kind of mite, and it will go after a number of kind of plants, but the one that we see it on in the greenhouse is this poinsettia. It looks a lot like nutrient deficiency on the left, and that's how typically what growers think about when they first see it or see it for the first time. Also, as color begins to break or appear on poinsettia, you get kind of a speckled sort of appearance, and sometimes there are these symptoms, especially on this leaf here, a virus that's commonly in poinsettias, so you'll want to be careful to distinguish what might be Lewis mite damage from what could be something else, say just color breaking or possible mild virus symptoms that usually doesn't affect the quality of the crop. So just take a look underneath the leaves and the mites should be pretty obvious. There are some other mites besides spider mites we deal with, and cyclamen mite appears now and then and can be kind of frustrating because you can't really see the mites, they're microscopic. But the damage they cause can be pretty dramatic. And you can see it on the lower right, that's on a African violet. That damage looks a lot like what could be caused by a foliar nematode. On the left is damage on a New Guinea, and the upper left is on a delphinium. A related mite, the broad mite, can cause not only all of the above symptoms, but these as well. You'll often see the bronzing and the curling of foliage, somewhat similar to what you'd see from chili thrips. So you'll probably want to either look for it closely or bring a sample in for diagnosis just to try to confirm what it is, because the controls will be different. Here's a symptom of broad mite damage on Salvia farinacea. You can see in the background there's some curling and kind of a bronzing color, not that bright green color that's normal, and the younger growth is starting to show it as well. This really gets going in very humid and warm conditions. It doesn't like it overly hot either, but the mild spring and early summer conditions are perfect for it in our greenhouses. Now, this is broad mite damage on impatiens, and you can see what it also looks like on the flower in the lower left. But this kind of curling looks an awful lot like downy mildew infection in impatiens too. So again, you'll want to try to distinguish between them because the controls will be very, very different. And you can either use a hand lens, an optimizer, or bring sample in, and we can probably tell you pretty quickly which one you're dealing with. Sometimes, if you're really sharp, you can see these eggs that are laid on the foliage or near the buds of plants from broad mite, and you can see they have kind of a speckled appearance. If I see these, then I am absolutely sure that you're dealing with broad mite, and then we know that there's a certain kind of control, something like Avid or a Hairy or sand mite, or some of the materials you can use to control that infestation. Let's talk about aphids a little bit. Here's typical obvious evidence of aphid infestations in the flowers here in the buds. One is the melon aphid on the left and the green peach aphid on the right. A lot of times you don't see aphids, especially when the numbers are very, very low, but you can sometimes see evidence that they're active. And there's some honeydew shining on the left and their calf skins over on the right that have dropped down as they've shed on the leaves below. And here's another shot from Nora Kaplan, the same sort of thing going on on a zonal geranium leaf. And you can see there's a couple of aphids on the leaf themselves and a little bit of sooty mold that's starting to grow as well. And this is, as it advances along, you could see there's more just of some of that sooty mold that grows on the honeybee, as well as the calf skin, the aphids that tell you you've got an aphid problem, you need to look a little more closely to check. And there's some aphids, specifically foxglove aphid, where you may see the damage they're causing before you actually see the aphids. Now, I don't see this with melon aphid or green peach, but foxglove is the one that tends to cause this sort of curling and distortion. This plant on the lower right here obviously has got something wrong with it. And on this plant here, you can see some curling and puckering of the leaves, and that's caused by foxglove aphid. This is one of the only aphids that we see in greenhouses that does this or causes this kind of symptom. And so when you see that, just take a closer look and see if you can find the aphids, if they're responsible. Chrysanthemum aphid has the dignity to be really obvious when it's there. It likes to feed, especially on stems. It'll go to leaves too. But and if the stems are green, it's really obvious, the contrast, so they show up pretty readily. And they're fairly easy to control too, which is good, especially if you get them early. To take a look, and when you're dealing with chrysanthemum aphid, look at the stems, especially, not just the leaves and the buds, where you'll see other kinds of aphids on that plant. Here's some green peach aphids, and they're pretty cryptic. They like to hide in all kinds of spots, and the coloring is very similar. You can see the ones on the stems here are would be otherwise very hard to detect. When they're on the flowers, they're a little bit easier to see. Here's some on the spur of the flower. So you kind of have to look almost everywhere, flowers, stems, leaves, and all around the plant when you're looking for aphids. Foxglove aphid tends to like to be lower down on the plant, but not always, and especially as you get into a bloom time, you may see them moving up towards the flowers more too. Let's talk about insect traps in another way we can monitor some of these insects. Yellow sticky traps are something that really came in the last 20 years and become almost a standard issue item if you're growing greenhouse crops. These are used mainly for thrips, whiteflies, fungus gnats, and short flies, but they're not very good for aphids, mealybugs, scale insects, and mites, and mostly because in the case of aphids, you can get high populations building up before you have winged individuals that would ever be trapped on cards. And with mealybugs and scale insects, for the most part, if there are any wing stages, they're relatively minor or few in number, and you wouldn't use them for detecting them, those infestations at all. And mites, there's no flying stages in mites. Some can be airborne, spread around that way, but you'll have heavy infestations before you start to see that. So the others are the ones you're mainly going to be watching for on these yellow sticky cards. You want to place these just over the crop canopy in a vertical orientation like this and move them up as the crop grows. And best to put them in areas, just use some logic, and it's obvious areas with good air movement or air circulation, areas where you've got a new crop that you've just brought in, vegetatively propagated. Older plants are good candidates for where you want to put cards. Any place that you see as possibly high risk. If you've got fans that are pulling air in the greenhouse, well, you want to put the card downwind where the air is coming out and coming in, maybe through the vents or through a doorway, as a way to detect what might be coming in and getting trapped on a sticky card, and then before that, infesting the crop. Blue cards are better for Western flower thrips, and some people do use them. And if you're dealing with a crop like African violet that is more prone to Western flower thrips than any of the other above pests, then there's a real good reason to use a blue sticky card. Or gloxinia, syningias, any of those would be really good candidates for blue sticky cards. But if you're concerned about all of the above pests, you would probably just stick with yellow. You certainly could use both. But I think blue is very good for crops where thrips are, Western flower thrips in particular, are going to be your main problem. One other refinement is we found out that short flies like cards when they're horizontally oriented. It's not necessary to do this, but you'll trap more of them this way. Short flies actually like red cards better than yellow, but we don't sell red cards and they're not really available. So yellow works just fine. So if necessary, and you're dealing with like a young plant situation like this and a lot of short flies, you might want to place them horizontally if you're monitoring short flies preferentially. So here's what Western flower thrips look like trapped on sticky cards. And I just wanted to remember that you can trap biocontrols on these, like errant monstrous will be trapped on a sticky card. So when you're putting a sticky card out, you don't want to release your biocontrols, your parasitoids, right next to where the sticky cards are, and you may not necessarily want to deploy sticky cards when you're using biocontrols. I think you still can, but just be aware that you will trap some of the biocontrols on these sticky cards, as well as some of the pests that you're really trying to look for. You can keep a record of what's on these cards. It's a great way to get a sense of what the trends are and how well your controls are working or not working. And you'd want to do it on a regular basis, say weekly, 10-day, 14-day interval, to keep track of what numbers you're finding. It gets hard to do, so you probably want to have some program or plan that minimizes the effort so you can reassure that it will get done during the times that it's most necessary. So it might be a good way to just keep an eye on what the numbers are from time to time and how those trends are going up or going down. Now, we don't use pheromone traps too much in greenhouses, but we're starting to look at them a little more, and there's a good reason to do so. And there's different designs. There's a wing trap on the left, and there's a bucket trap in the center, and there's a water pan trap on the right. And there's other designs too. There's a delta trap and several others you can use. Now, there's some rules about this, but it really kind of depends what pest you're monitoring in particular. On the lower right, the trap photo was taken from a publication out of Ogeningen where they're monitoring this European pepper moth, or Duponcellia. And you can use the wing trap on the upper left for this, but the water pan trap actually works better. There's something about that higher humidity, that moisture, that water that's highly attractive to the moths. So in addition to the pheromone, which you can see in here in the very center, there's also water in this trap to enhance the attractiveness of this trap for that particular moth. So you can, as I say, use a wing trap and that's fine, but if you have available a water pan trap, you'll probably end up trapping more moths and have sort of enhanced ability to detect the infestations that way. Yellow-striped armyworm worm is one example that we've been dealing with recently. This one seems to build up in the late summer, and then we have greenhouse problems as a result from fall and sometimes into winter as a consequence, and they've moved in. And we've been using some pheromone traps at greenhouse operations to help us understand whether this is continuing to overwinter in the greenhouse. We've actually had some spring problems from this in the greenhouse from overwintering. So the traps can help us to determine when we need to keep on it or when we've actually got the problem under control and can relax again. Finally, the plants themselves sometimes are good traps. This is a Nicotiana plant that ended up being a very good trap for shore flies and fungus gnats. You can see a lot of them were trapped and killed on the sticky hairs that are on this plant right there. So these are some thoughts or ideas about monitoring for insects and mites in greenhouse crops. We didn't cover all of them, but given the short time, I wanted to focus on a few and discuss ways of monitoring and detecting them. To make your job a little bit easier. And if you have any questions, I'd be glad to address those. Also, in addition to the poinsettia scouting protocol noted earlier, there is the scouting and pest management guide that is available online at this website through the New York State IPM program that's for bedding plants. And with that, I think I'll turn it back over to you, Brian and Betsy.
All right. Thank you, Dan. Excellent information for monitoring for insects and mites. If you have any questions, please send those through chat, and Dan or I could answer those questions. So we'll give you a couple of minutes to do that, to send your questions over.
I have one for you while you're waiting for other people. As to what equipment that you would recommend that growers have. Hand lens, certainly, do you think 10X or 16X? And what about having a simple dissecting microscope? That could be for either of you or both.
Yeah, well, I'll start out from the disease end. Yeah, a hand lens, a magnifier of any kind. And, you know, if you're comfortable with just a traditional magnifying glass, the larger one, that could be used, but for portability, nothing beats a little hand lens that can be carried with you at all times. Some people carry them around their neck, and then they can flip it out and take a look closely at the underside of the leaves. You can see sometimes the fungal sporulation there if we're looking for diseases, and get a close-up view of some of those insects. And yeah, you may want to have a dissecting microscope if you have the opportunity to take some leaves away from the greenhouse, taking some samples. Then you could take those back and look at those in another location. Probably not going to have those out in the greenhouse because the moisture in the microscope is not a great combination, but you really can get a much better view of things with some magnification, especially with a dissecting microscope if you're at that level of diagnostic. And Dan, I don't know what your feelings are.
Yeah, I'd concur with all of that. I guess on the hand lens, I would add that if you've never used a hand lens before, maybe get a 10x lens to start. The higher in power you go, in some ways it's better, but they become a little harder to use. So I would start with a 10x, and they're pretty inexpensive, a few dollars. You can get a decent one. If you are comfortable with it, I'd work up to a 15 or even a 20x. As I say, they become a little harder to use. You have to adjust your looking to make it easier. You need to have that light really bouncing off the leaf that you're trying to look at. Don't wear a hat with a brim, for example, and have the light behind you. But I'd start with a 10 and maybe work up if you have been comfortable with it and you like the way it's working. If you can, I like the optivisors even better. I think they go up to about 10x. They make it easier so you can just have your hands free and they can sit on your head and they flip up out of the way when you don't need them. So they're a pretty handy thing to have. And some people buy them just for reading, but they're also very, very good for scouting. I would agree with the dissecting scope. They're great for a few $100. You can get an okay one. And you sometimes even have the capability of taking photographs. And then, of course, you could email them or keep them. And we could look at them, too, and maybe tell you what it is we see. But they do make it a lot easier. Something about 40x, 50x power would be what you'd want. And if it's worth it to you, that's a great idea. But you have to weigh the costs with your need for it.
All right, I see a question came through, probably for you, Dan, asking if we have recommendations for sticky card pheromone trap sources. So where could a grower go to get these sticky cards or pheromone traps?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. There's several places you can go, and there's some in the back of some of the Cornell guidelines. I know in the tree fruit guidelines at the IPMguidelines.org webpage, you'll see the Cornell Tree Fruit Guide there. In the back of that guide, there's a listing of sources there. You can get some from, say, Griffin or another dealer, dealers here, Green Island on Long Island, Griffin Supply has sticky cards. They sometimes have access to different kinds of traps. Great Lakes IPM is one place that sells traps as well, and there's several other suppliers that you can find online that have them. For some things, you may need to make a special order. For yellow-striped armyworm is the one that comes to mind. That pheromone itself isn't readily available, but you can get it by special order. And if you have any questions about any of these, where you can get them, I'd be glad to help you out finding sources for particular items.
Good.
So I had a concept I was going to broach, if you folks can hear me.
Yes, we can.
Yep. Okay.
Good to hear you.
This is Marjorie Daughtry. And you were showing pictures of the powdery mildew on poinsettia, which reminded me that that is the disease that gave me the idea that scouting was really important. Because there was one disaster story many years back where a grower started growing poinsettias for the first time and was not interested in putting the extra dollars into hiring a scout, and he was not all that aware of the potential problem from powdery mildew, and he did not scout for it, and he ended up losing his entire crop to that disease because he didn't have the scouting component worked into his operation, either internally or by paying an external scout. So that's my scare story. Perhaps some of the rest of you have scare stories too about what happens
Very
if
important.
You don't scout.
Yeah, great reminder about that. And I haven't experienced that. I think it isn't that common, but all the more reason to have a trained eye to look for something like that, especially in the early stages. Good warning there that it could affect an entire crop. Thank you. All right, I'm not seeing any other questions or comments. So I think we will wrap up. And Dan gave us a preview of next week's topic with some of his nice images of some beneficial insects. And next week is the first of two sessions on biological control. And we'll hear from Betsy Lamb and John Sanderson next week, also Thursday and at 2 o'clock, so at the same time. We hope you can join us then.